Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Chapel Lemon Grove. We're going to pray and we're going to worship the Lord this morning. Dear Father God, Lord, we come before you this morning just seeking you, Lord, and just wanting to worship you, Lord. So right now, we just want to empty out our hearts and our minds and everything that's distracting to us, Lord, that would take away from worshiping you this morning. We lay it at your feet and ask that this worship to you would be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Still as you call me, deeper still. Good morning, Calvary Chapel Lemon Grove family. We're sorry that we can't be here with you in person this morning, but this is not a bad alternative. So for this week, we're going to just post the service online, and then after that, we will return hopefully to our normal operations next week.
To die.
just ask that the rest of this morning we'd be blessed by your word, that you open up our hearts and our minds, Lord, to receive everything that comes from you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now I'd like to introduce my son, Michael. Michael is a man of God's word, and Michael would like to read Psalm 124 for you this morning. So, Michael, come on up.
Okay. Psalm 124. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
Good. Thank you, Michael. Right. Thank you, Michael. So this morning we are going to be in the book of Philemon. And what I'd like to do, normally we do a responsive reading, but since that's not going to be the case this morning, I'd like to just go ahead and read the book of Philemon to you. And I know that sounds like a big deal, but it's really not that long a book. It's one of Paul's shorter letters. So let's go ahead and read the book of Philemon together. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved friend. Let me start that again. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus. I did it again. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer, to the beloved Apphia, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers, hearing of your love and faith which you have toward the Lord Jesus and toward all the saints, that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. For we have great joy and consolation in your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed by you, brother. Therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to command you what is fitting, yet for love's sake I rather appeal to you, being such a one as Paul, the aged, and now also a prisoner of Christ, of Jesus Christ. I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains, who once was unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me. I am sending him back. You therefore receive him, that is, my own heart, whom I wish to keep with me, that on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. But without your consent I wanted to do nothing, that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. For perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose, that you might receive him forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. If then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. But if he has wronged you or owes you anything, put that on my account. I, Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay, not to mention that to you that you owe me even your own self besides. Yes, brother, let me have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in the Lord. Having confidence in your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. But meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be granted to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, greets you, as do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, Luke, my fellow laborers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. So this morning, as I was saying, we were in the book of Philemon, of course. And this is one of those books where you have to pay attention or you'll go right past it. Philemon was written by Paul the Apostle to a man named, and I know this is going to shock you, Philemon. Philemon lived in Colossae. This epistle was written at the same time that Paul wrote his epistles to the his epistle to the Colossians, around the year AD 62. Now, in the body of the Colossian epistle, he said he was sending the letter with Tychicus. He also said he was sending a man named Onesimus with him. He told the Colossians that Onesimus is one of you. The letter to Philemon directly involves Onesimus. You see, Onesimus was a slave at one time. He was actually Philemon's slave. Evidently, he stole some money and ran away. Now, Paul is sending Onesimus back to Colossae with this letter, Philemon. Paul is interceding on Onesimus's behalf. He wants Philemon to receive Onesimus, no longer as a slave, but as a brother in Christ. This is one of Paul's prison epistles. In it, he asks Philemon to be merciful and gracious to Onesimus. Philemon would prepare a place for Paul to stay. When Paul wrote this, he was expecting to be released from prison soon. This was Paul's first imprisonment, and it was really more of a house arrest in Rome. He was chained to a guard at all times, but he could apparently leave his rented room at any time, as long as the guard went with him. Eventually, Paul was indeed released. Later, of course, he was rearrested and executed. Philemon begins, "Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ." Did you catch that? Paul didn't identify himself as a prisoner of the Roman government. He says, "I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ." Paul usually begins his letter by identifying himself as an apostle of Jesus Christ. This time, he's a prisoner of Jesus Christ. It was his love for Jesus that placed him in bonds. He didn't consider himself to be a prisoner of Rome. That makes a big difference in how you look at things. If only I was more like Paul. When I feel chained by circumstances or imprisoned by problems, I'd realize that I wouldn't be there unless the Lord had allowed it to be so for his purposes. God used Paul mightily because Paul understood that whatever situation in which he found himself was due not to man's politics, but to God's sovereignty. We Christians often get out of sorts because we tend to personalize the reproach that comes on us for the cause of Jesus Christ. If I'm sharing my faith in Christ or my love for the Lord with someone and they get upset with me, maybe call me names, something like that, I'm prone to personalize the remarks. But I should remember that the animosity that they feel is really not directed towards me. It's directed toward the Lord that I represent. It's important for us to make that distinction in our minds. And in the early church, when our ancestors in the faith were beaten and told not to preach anymore in Jesus' name, they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer for the cause of Christ. Rome couldn't hold Paul, nor could it hold back the work of God's Spirit in Paul's life. So Paul said, "I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ." When you see things that way, it puts your experiences in a whole different light. We can endure. We can accept hardships when we realize they're for the Lord, that it's in his name and for his cause that we're experiencing these things. When Paul talked to the Ephesians on the beach at Miletus, he told them how he was with them serving the Lord. We need to realize that the Lord is our master. We are serving him. Whatever might befall us does so for his sake, for his glory. We are his servants. The result of our service are because of that service. So I too am a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Verse 1 continues, "And Timothy, our brother." Timothy was well known to the church at Colossae. He had ministered there with Paul. Now Paul adds his name to this epistle, perhaps because he was growing older and he wanted to prepare others to accept his protege's ministry and his authority. Verse 1 continues, "To Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer." This is the only place in the New Testament where Philemon is mentioned by name. Paul tells us that Philemon was his beloved friend. In the 13 letters that Paul wrote to individuals or to churches, he called himself an apostle in the opening verse of 9 of those letters. Paul is appealing to Philemon more as a friend and less as an apostle. And now he's going to extend greetings to Philemon's household. Verse 2, to the beloved Apphia, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Now, Apphia was probably Philemon's wife. Apphia is a feminine name. Some commentators believe that Archippus was Philemon's son, and this address to family members is unique among Paul's letters. But considering the content of this letter to Philemon, that makes sense. You see, Paul is going to appeal to Philemon regarding a runaway slave who has met Jesus and found refuge with Paul. According to the customs of the day, Philemon's wife, Apphia, would supervise the household slaves. So the letter concerned her, too. Paul speaks of Archippus as a fellow soldier, a phrase used of those who were also ministering together in the gospel. This phrase, to the church in your house, means that the Colossian church, or a portion of it, met in Philemon's house. The earliest Christians didn't have property of their own for church buildings. The Jews had their synagogues, but Christians met in the homes of their members. The Christians of a city gathered into different house churches, with a city bishop overseeing the different house churches. Paul also mentioned house churches in Romans chapter 16 and Colossians chapter 4. Back in Philemon verse 3, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So here's Paul's customary greeting of grace and peace. It's found in all of his letters. In this case, it was directed toward Philemon as an individual rather than to an entire congregation. That is one of the things that makes this letter unique among Paul's writings. The pastoral epistles of 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus were also written first to individuals, but the nature of their content suggests that they were intended to be shared with the entire congregation, whereas Philemon is really a personal note that Paul wrote to one man. Verse 4, I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers. The people that God uses are people of prayer, among other things. Paul makes frequent references to his personal prayer life. In all of the epistles, he mentions how he is praying for them continually, and in some of them, he says that he's interceding for them night and day. Paul's life was a life of prayer. He was constantly in prayer because he realized its power. Paul was imprisoned in Rome, probably in the Mamertine prison. He was chained to a Roman guard, but Rome could not stop the witness of Jesus Christ. Through prayer, Paul was continuing his work in the churches that he had established as he prayed for them. The interesting thing about prayer is that it's not bound to locality like service is. We have a hierarchy in our minds. We think that serving the Lord is one of the most important things we can do. And don't get me wrong, service is important, but prayer is even more important. What do you mean? Well, there are times when our service must be limited due to circumstances beyond our control. Think about it. If you're sitting there in a jail cell and you're chained to a Roman guard, your service is going to be pretty restricted. But all the might of Rome could not restrict the power of Paul's prayers. Even as he sat there in jail, he continued to exercise a very dynamic and powerful prayer ministry. Through prayer, he went around to the various churches and the various individuals, mentioning them by name. Here in verse 4, Paul speaks of how he always mentions Philemon in his prayers. No doubt Paul had a very extensive prayer list. He prayed for the specific churches, then he prayed for the leaders within those churches by name, holding them up before the Lord. This demonstrates the tremendous power of prayer. And even as he sat there in his jail cell, through prayer he went out to the provinces of Asia Minor, on into Greece, back to Jerusalem, doing work for God while confined in that jail cell. Philemon verse 5, hearing of your love and faith which you have toward the Lord Jesus and toward all the saints. Paul gave thanks for Philemon. He heard of the love that Philemon had, as well as the faith that he demonstrated toward all the saints in communicating his faith. In 1927, Sir Arthur Newsholm published the first copy of his famous sketch called Evolution of Preventive Medicine. It was the first English outline of the history of preventive medicine, and there's a lot of talk about preventive medicine today, keeping people healthy rather than merely taking care of them once they're sick. Paul models something different. He models not preventive medicine, but preventive ministry. When he tells Philemon, hearing that your family is walking with the Lord and there is a church in your house causes me to pray for you constantly. However, that's not our regular tendency. We generally only pray for people when we hear that they're sick or struggling or going through difficult trials or facing hard times. Pray we should and pray we must. I suggest that we pray like Paul. We should pray for those doing well, that they might do even better. Often, it's when our enemy sees people doing well that he decides to launch an attack against them. Why? Because he knows that he has lost their souls. But he also knows that if he can pull them down into depression or discouragement, he knows that they'll be unable to impact others whose souls he hasn't yet lost. Satan doesn't spend his time on the lost. You'll never read in the New Testament where Satan himself is warring against an unbeliever. Yes, as the prince of darkness, he blinds the eyes of unbelievers. You can read about that in Ephesians chapter 2 and 2 Corinthians chapter 4. But as far as spiritual attacks are concerned, he totally and exclusively saves himself for those who are in Christ, for those who are walking with God. In every New Testament instance where you see Satan, you always see him coming against believers to minimize their effectiveness for the kingdom of God. This is why it's important for you to pray, for us to pray, for those doing well. They're surely the enemy's targets. Philemon verse 6, that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. So Paul prayed for Philemon, desiring that the sharing of his faith would become effective as Philemon understood the work that God did in him. That's the foundation for all effective evangelism, the overflow of a life that God has touched and changed. God had done every good thing in Philemon's life. Now it was a matter of that being acknowledged by both Philemon and those that he shared the faith with. When these good things were understood, others would come to Jesus. Much sharing of faith is ineffective because we don't know or can't communicate every good thing that God has done for us. That work of Jesus Christ within Paul's life was demonstrated by his faith, a life of love and a life of sharing with those within the body of Christ. Verse 7, for we have great joy and consolation in your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed by you, brother. Paul remembered how wonderfully Philemon had met the needs of other Christians. He effectively refreshed the hearts of others. And now Paul is going to get to the subject matter, Onesimus. Verse 8, therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to command you what is fitting, yet for love's sake I rather appeal to you. As an apostle, Paul had the authority to order a person to do something. Paul was saying, I could order you to do this, but I won't. I'm not going to order you. I'm going to beg you. I'm beseeching you. In Luke's gospel, Jesus said, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those who exercise authority over them are called benefactors. But it shall not be so among you, for whoever would be the chief among you, let him be the servant of all. That's from Luke chapter 22. So here's Paul. He has authority as an apostle. Rather than coming down on him with all of his authority and saying, now Philemon, this is what I'm commanding you to do, he said, I'm begging you to do this, Philemon. He's appealing to the love that he knows is within Philemon, to the compassion this man has demonstrated. How much better it is when someone comes appealing to the higher nature of love. There are some who aren't moved much by love. So the Bible says you've got to save some by fear. Some preachers really take that scripture to heart, and they dangle people over the pit of hell every Sunday so they might save some by fear. But there's another scripture that says, don't you realize that it's the goodness of God that brings a man to repentance? That's from Romans chapter 2. Now, some are saved by fear, but that's a base motivation. Paul said, it's the love of Christ that constrains me. Those drawn by the love of Christ are responding to a higher motivation. Paul chooses to appeal to the higher motivation, begging him because of the love he knows that Philemon possesses. Therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to command you that what is right or fitting, yet for love's sake I rather appeal to you. Verse 9 continues, being such a one as Paul, the aged. How old was Paul? Well, at this point, he's probably in his late 50s or early 60s. But he endured such hardship for the cause of Christ that his body was a wreck. He spoke of his sicknesses many times. He was only around 60, but he spoke of himself as aged. And now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Here again, he acknowledges that he wasn't a prisoner of Rome, but rather a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Verse 10, I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains. Now, while Paul was chained to a Roman guard, he encountered a man named Onesimus. As we mentioned earlier, Onesimus was a fugitive in the city of Rome, a runaway slave who had stolen goods from his master. It's possible that Paul bumped into Onesimus in the marketplace and began to dialogue with him. It's also possible that Onesimus was arrested and chained to the same guard as Paul was. We don't know exactly how their paths crossed, but crossed they did. Onesimus found that there's no freedom in freedom itself. Although he was free from his master, he was still a slave to his own conscience, to his own sin. Onesimus was to discover that although there's slavery and freedom, there's also freedom in slavery. How? Well, Jesus calls all those who are weary and heavy laden to take his yoke upon them, to be chained to him, so to speak, as Matthew chapter 11 tells us. But he's a good master, and all do find freedom in slavery to him. That's why Paul said, I am a bondslave, a slave by choice. See Romans chapter 1. Marriage proves this point, for it is, in a sense, slavery. It can be either glorious or it can be miserable, depending on the one with whom you are linked. The question in this life is not whether or not you're yoked, but to whom are you yoked? If we're yoked to Jesus, we are yoked to quintessentially the excellent master, to the one who loved us so much, who loves us so much, to the one who's so good for us, and the one who's so good to us. Onesimus realized that although Paul was in chains, he was free. And though he, Onesimus, was free, he was enslaved to his own sin. Onesimus was led to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ by Paul the Apostle. Verse 11, who once was unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me. You can almost see the twinkle in Paul's eye as he writes this, for he employs a play on words that Philemon was sure to appreciate. You see, Onesimus means profitable. Although Onesimus had been a most unprofitable slave to Philemon when he stole from him and ran away, Paul knew that the born-again Onesimus would now be highly profitable to Philemon because his friendship and help were already of great value to Paul. Verse 12, I am sending him back. You, therefore, receive him, that is, my own heart. In escaping from his master, Onesimus had done something wrong. It was time to set that right, so Paul was willing to send him back. Paul obviously wanted Philemon to deal gently with Onesimus. Under Roman law, you see, the slave owner had complete and total control over his slave. It wasn't unusual for slaves to be crucified for lesser offenses than escaping. Considering the huge number of slaves in the Roman Empire, they thought the harsh punishment against escaped or rebellious slaves was necessary. In an empire with as many as 60 million slaves, there were constant fears of a slave revolt. Therefore, laws against runaways were strict. When runaway slaves were captured, they might be crucified or perhaps branded on their forehead with a red-hot iron with the letter F for fugitive. When we think of it that way, we understand Paul's phrase, that is, my own heart. Philemon, I know this man has done you wrong, and he deserves to be punished, but consider him as my own heart and be merciful to him. Verse 13, whom I wish to keep with me, that on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. Meaning, Philemon, I know you'd like to be here, helping me in this condition, but Onesimus has been here representing you, doing the work that you'd like to be doing for me, while I'm here in these bonds. Clearly, Paul wanted Onesimus to stay. He had become a big help. Since he was a slave, Onesimus had the miserable lot in life of a slave. One of the most horrible, heinous things that a man could ever do to his fellow man is to bring one into slavery. My heart goes out to those people who have become slaves of the state in communist countries. One of man's greatest evils is the oppression of his fellow man. And sadly, we're closer to that than I ever thought we'd be in this country. Socialism and communism have become miserable, abject failures. Everywhere, people have been subjected to their cruel burdens. Even so, many in our country seem to overlook the flaws of these failed systems as they try to drag us under the control of the tyranny and the enslavement to which they want to subject us. In the Roman Empire, a slave had no rights of any kind. There was no one to whom a slave could appeal. If you were beaten, if you were robbed, you couldn't appeal to anybody. As a slave, there was no authority that would protect you. Your master had sole and complete authority over your existence, which he had the right to terminate at any time that he desired. He could kill you, and he would not have to answer to any charges. Slaves were often beaten or kept in the most miserable conditions by sadists who delighted in torturing them. They had a miserable lot indeed. Of course, in his letter to the Ephesians, Paul enjoined those who were masters to treat their slaves with kindness and with love. With Philemon, Paul is making an appeal. Now, if he so chose, Philemon had the legal right to put Onesimus to death, or he could have branded him with the F on his forehead. Paul is telling Philemon, I want you to receive him. Philemon, verse 14. But without your consent, I wanted to do nothing, that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. God does not want anything we do for him or give to him to be given out of necessity or pressure. God never uses pressure tactics on man. Now, man often uses pressure tactics. I have received many extremely high-pressure letters filled with hype from these evangelists who would have me to believe that God is broke. They tell me how much money to send and that I need to send it immediately. They've even suggested that if I don't have it immediately available in my own account, that I should go down to the bank and borrow it. They tell me that I need to send it to them right away to bail God out of the jam that he's in because he overspent again last month. Pressure. Paul said, I don't want to receive anything from you by necessity, by pressure, by manipulation. Now, I would like to have kept Onesimus with me, but I wouldn't do that unless you gave your permission. Though he would have been very helpful to me. I want that which you do to be done not out of pressure, not out of necessity, but rather I want you to do it willingly. And in his second Corinthian epistle, Paul said that our giving shouldn't be of necessity. It shouldn't be out of pressure. Rather, everyone should purpose, and so let him give. For God loves a cheerful, or in the Greek, hilarious, giver. That's from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. What you give to God, give hilariously. What you can't give hilariously, keep it. It's better for you to keep it than to grudgingly give it. God doesn't want anything done, nor is he pleased by anything done that grudgingly. If you want to serve the Lord, serve him with a joyful, happy, willing heart. If you want to give to God, give with a joyful, happy, willing heart. If you can't give with a joyful, happy, willing heart, don't give. In that case, it's better not to give, because you won't get any reward for it anyway. If you give to God and you say, well, here you are, God, or you give something to him and you didn't go around griping about it, God just marks it off as though you hadn't given it. You won't get any credit for it, so you might as well keep it. So Paul said, I would like to have kept Onesimus with me. He was really a blessing to me. But I want it to be from your heart. I want you to do so willingly. Verse 15, for perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose, that you might receive him forever. So often we don't know what God is working out in our lives when we have disappointments. When Onesimus took Philemon's money and split, no doubt Philemon was very upset. And he was probably saying, why would God allow him to rip me off like that and take off? Why would God allow this to happen? So Paul says, look, you don't know. Maybe this was all a part of God's plan to reach Onesimus with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Maybe you lost him for a little bit that you might gain him forever. It was while he was in Rome that he came to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and now he's an eternal brother in Christ. So you lost him for a moment, but you gained him forever. He's now an eternal brother in the bond of Jesus Christ. It's interesting that during the hippie counterculture revolution, thousands and thousands of young people left home. Many of them ran away from home. Their parents were so upset and disturbed that their children had run away from home. However, in their searching, many of them found Jesus Christ as the answer for their quest of life. Their parents lost them for a little while, but they gained them as eternal brothers and sisters in the Lord. God did the work in their heart. Sometimes a wife or a husband leaves. There's such sorrow and grief, but you don't know. You don't know what God is working out. You don't know, but maybe they've left for a season that God might do an eternal work within their lives and bring things together as he wants them to be. It's so important for us to learn to commit our ways to the Lord, every situation, and think, well, Lord, you're in control. My life belongs to you. And I know, Lord, that you are controlling the circumstances that surround my life. So, Lord, work out your plan. Rather than getting upset or fretting, or getting angry, it's best that we commit it to the Lord and say, well, Lord, you're in control. I don't know what you're doing, but I trust you, Lord. And that's where faith comes in. Now, if I only believe God when I can see what he's doing, or when I can understand his work, that isn't faith. That doesn't take any faith. What takes faith is to have that rest and that confidence when things seem to be going completely against me. But they often seem to be that way. It's like when Jacob said, all things are against me, in Genesis chapter 42. Why did he cry that? Because he didn't see everything. He said all things, but he was wrong. All things weren't against him. If only he had known the truth. Some of the greatest, happiest moments of his life were just around the corner. That guy in Egypt that seems to be so mean and so hard is in reality his son Joseph, of whom he has been bereaved for so many years. Well, he'll soon discover that his son is alive. And he's going to be embracing Joseph again. He doesn't know the whole picture. He only sees a part of it, and he cries out in dismay. So often we only see a part of the picture, and we too cry out in dismay. All things are against me. Oh, no, no, no. You don't know the full cycle. You don't know the whole story. You don't know what God is working out. Just wait. Trust in the Lord. Rest in him. Let God work it out. You'll find that God's plan was far wiser than anything you could have devised. As he began to put together that eternal work in the hearts and lives of your friends, or in your own heart, your own life, as you learn to trust in him more completely. It's so important that we learn to commit things to the Lord, even those things that seem to be against us. Looking at the consequences of Onesimus's running away, Paul's rationale is really very reasonable. The consequence was that Onesimus came to Jesus Christ. He became a brother in Christ and will now share eternity together with Philemon. The end result is that Onesimus, who was once unprofitable, has become profitable. So Paul says, I want you to receive him. Verse 16, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. Paul is asking for more than just forgiveness for Onesimus. He's asking for a total pardon from even the slavery that he once endured. I want you to receive him, not as a slave anymore, more than a slave. I want you to receive him as a beloved brother. Release him from that slavery. Verse 17, if then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. Philemon, if our relationship has meant anything to you, if you count me as a partner, receive Onesimus as you would receive me. That was a powerful appeal. You see, he stood beside a guilty man, and he said to the slave's owner, I know this man is a criminal. I know he's a criminal and that he deserves punishment. Yet this slave is my friend. So if you punish him, punish me also. I stand beside him to take his punishment. That's what Jesus does for us before our master, God the Father. Verse 18, but if he has wronged you or owes you anything, put that on my account. By stealing from Philemon, Onesimus had committed a capital crime. Paul asked that the value of what had been stolen would be charged to his account. Put it on my tab, Philemon. Verse 19, I, Paul, am writing with my own hand, I will repay. Here we see Paul, the intercessor, interceding with Philemon for this unprofitable slave who has now been converted to Jesus Christ, asking for his release from slavery, that he would be received as a brother, and even above that, to be received as Paul himself, and to be forgiven any debt that he owes, or at least that his debt would be charged to Paul. Paul promises that he will reimburse. He says, I will repay. That's intercession. The Bible says that Jesus is able to save to the uttermost since he lives to make intercession for us in Hebrews chapter 7. Isaiah prophesied that Jesus would make intercession for the transgressors, Isaiah chapter 53. And in Romans chapter 8, Paul says, who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Jesus is not condemning you. He does not condemn you, has not condemned you, will not condemn you. Jesus said, I didn't come to condemn the world, but that the world through me might be saved, John chapter 3. Who then is he that condemns? It isn't Jesus. He's making intercession for you. Even as Paul interceded for Onesimus, so does Jesus intercede for you. Father, I want you to receive them, no longer as sinners, but as those who have been washed and cleansed. Father, I want you to treat them even as you treat me. If they owe you anything, put it on my account. So all of my sins are charged to Jesus. All of my guilt is charged to him. God laid on him the iniquities of us all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. The last verse of that song is pretty cool. When from my dying bed my ransomed soul shall rise, Jesus died my soul to save shall rend the vaulted skies. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, I'll lay my trophies down, all down at Jesus' feet. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. In his intercession for you and for me, Jesus is asking that we receive with him the honor and glory of the eternal kingdom, to let all our guilt be transferred to his account. He has accepted the responsibility for all of our debt. Paul says, I have written it with my own hand. I will repay it. Verse 19 continues, not to mention to you that you owe me even your own self besides. Paul says, I'll pay Onesimus's debt, and I won't even bring up the fact that since I'm your spiritual mentor, you owe me your very life. Sometimes pastors have to lay guilt trips on people. Verse 20, yes, brother, let me have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in the Lord. Having confidence in your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. Some people can't understand why Paul would send Onesimus back into potential slavery. But this passage strongly suggests that Paul knew Philemon would set Onesimus free. Verse 22, but meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be granted to you. Now, I also want you to prepare me a place to stay. By God's grace, I'll be there before long. Verse 23, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, greets you, as do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, Luke, my fellow laborers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. Paul joins his name in this greeting to Philemon with the same people he did in his greeting to the Colossian church as we come to the close of this short personal letter. As always, Paul leaves us in the place of grace. Next week, we're going to begin our journey through the book of James with a study on James chapter 1. So read ahead. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this time. We thank you, Lord, for the wonders of technology that enable us to share your word, even when we're not able to do so in person. And now, Lord, we pray that you would take the lessons we've learned and impress them deeply upon our hearts, overcome the frailties and weaknesses of the messenger, and cause your people to abound with your love, abound in an understanding of the debt that you have paid. You have, in fact, paid it all. All to you we owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. You washed it white as snow. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Souls, the lover of our souls, the one who died for us, the one who rose for us. May he just pour out his precious Holy Spirit in your lives. And may he cause you to share the love of Jesus Christ with the people around you in whatever circumstances you might find yourself. The Lord bless thee. And keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up,
the Lord lift up
his
countenance
upon thee and give thee peace. May God richly bless you.